now that we have practiced doing a one sample t-test by hand, we are going to do that same one sample t-test in SPSS. If SPSS is not already open on your computer, open it now. We are going to import our data from Sheet 2 of an Excel spreadsheet that we created in the last video. This example will work even if you do not have the Excel file that I mentioned. You can create it along the way. This is Sheet 2 of the MarthaStewart.xls Excel spreadsheet that we're going to import into SPSS. We can see that the variable name is men, and that we have 9 scores for each of the men who participated in this test. If you do not have this Excel spreadsheet, stop the video now and enter the data that you see here. Put the data on Sheet 2 so that you can more easily follow the directions as I explain them. Save the Excel file to your desktop. Before we import this Excel data into SPSS, let me remind you of 2 important points. First, the Excel spreadsheet must be closed in Excel. This process will not work if the spreadsheet is still being used by Excel. Second, you should have saved the Excel file to your desktop, so you must navigate to the desktop in order to be able to see the file. Once you have SPSS open on your desktop, you can open the Excel file using the commands File, Open, Data. Navigate to the desktop to view the file. You will immediately notice that although you are looking at the desktop, you do not see the Excel file. And that is because SPSS is currently looking for files of type .sav. Those are SPSS files. We need to change our files of type to Excel. Now we see the Martha Stewart dataset on the desktop. Click Open. By default, SPSS will read the variable names from the first row of data, and this is exactly what we want. We have already named our variable men. And also by default, SPSS will look at the first sheet of the Excel spreadsheet. However, do you remember what sheet we put our data on? Sheet 2. So we need to change the worksheet to Sheet 2 in order to open these data. Click OK. And there are our data. Alternatively, if your version of SPSS has this option, you can save a step when you open a file using the command File, Import Data, Excel. Select the same file on the desktop, choose Sheet 2, and click OK. These techniques for opening a file from Excel work exactly the same in SPSS. We can see in variable view that men is a numeric variable. It does not have a label yet, but we know that these are scale data. Change the measure to scale if necessary. Now we are ready to do our one sample t-test in SPSS. But first, let's walk through the 5 steps of hypothesis testing again so that we know what we are doing with this test. Step 1. Select the appropriate statistic. The appropriate statistic for comparing a sample mean to a known population value, when the population standard deviation is unknown, is the one sample t-test. Step 2. State the null and alternative hypotheses. We want to know if the mean for men is different than the mean for women. So this is a non-directional, two-tailed test. The null and alternative hypotheses are going to be exactly the same as when we did this by hand. The null hypothesis is H0: mu equals 73, where 73 is the mean of the population. The alternative hypothesis is H1: mu does not equal 73. Step 3, select a level of significance. For selecting our level of significance, we will be using a two-tailed test because we are not establishing a direction that the dependent variable will change. For most research, the level of significance will be alpha equals 0.05. Technically, you could set alpha equal to any value that you desired, but for scientific research, you really have only two choices: alpha equals 0.05 and alpha equals 0.01. Unless the problem says otherwise, assume that the alpha is 0.05, two-tailed test. The degrees of freedom always equals n minus 1, where n is the number of participants in your sample. In this case, with 9 men, our degrees of freedom are 8. To find the critical value, we go to Student's t-distribution table. We are using a two-tailed test, so we focus on the columns on the left. The alpha level is 0.05, with 8 degrees of freedom, so the critical value is positive or negative 2.306. Alternatively, you can download the RStats effect size calculator for t-tests and use it to determine your critical value. So here you see 6 things that you can do with this effect size calculator spreadsheet. If you click on the salmon-colored tab, you will see a full t-table of critical values for two-tailed tests, complete with a picture of William Seeley Gossett, our old friend's student. So we could use this table, find our alpha level and degrees of freedom, and determine our critical value. But there is something else that I want to show you. Click on the green tab labeled Critical Values. In the upper left, we have the typical setup for alpha equals 0.05 two-tailed test. Simply enter your degrees of freedom, click or hit return, and your critical value 2.306 appears here. But wait, there's more. If you are not doing a typical two-tailed alpha of 0.05 t-test, enter your degrees of freedom here. Click, and you'll get the critical values for both one and two-tailed tests at a variety of alpha levels. And I will tell you more about this green box in a moment. So any values exceeding positive or negative 2.306 indicate that the sample of men is statistically significantly different than the population value, the comparison mean, for women. Step 4, calculate the statistics. Let's go back to SPSS. We will conduct a one-sample t-test on these data by going to Analyze, Compare Means, One Sample T-Test. The only variable that we have available is men. So move men into Test Variables window. Now here's something very important. We have to tell SPSS what is our comparison value. In this case, the comparison value is the mean of the population, which we have already established is 73, the mean for women. Enter 73 into test value. Again, 73 is the mean of the population or the comparison value. Think for a moment about your null hypothesis. We are saying that this sample is drawn from a population that has a mean of 73. I say that this is very important because if you do not enter a number for test value in this box, then the comparison value, by default, will be 0. And if you compare to a value of 0, typically you will get the wrong answer. So click OK, and the output window will pop up. Let's look at this output more closely. In the output window, we see a box labeled One Sample Statistics. In this box, we see the sample size, 9, the mean, 66.56, the standard deviation, 5.981, and the standard error of the mean. We will use these for the APA write-up. Hopefully, you remember calculating the standard deviation and standard error of the mean when we conducted our one sample t-test by hand. If so, you will recognize this 1.99 as the estimated standard error of the mean. Scroll down a little to the one sample test box. So how can we interpret these findings? Well, first, the t-test value is a negative 3.232. In this case, the negative value for t means that our sample mean is less than our comparison value of 73. You interpret a positive t-value and a negative t-value exactly the same way. The sign only indicates whether your sample was larger or smaller than the comparison value. We have seen this t-value before when we did the test by hand. SPSS is calculating exactly the same value. The t-value of negative 3.232 exceeds the critical value of negative 2.306. Degrees of freedom is 8. We can see that the significance value for this t-test is 0.012, which is less than 0.05. And we also see that the 95% confidence interval for the difference between sample means, which is mean 1 minus mean 2, shows a lower bound of negative 11.04 and an upper bound of negative 1.85. Because this confidence interval does not cross zero, it does not include the hypothesized null value of zero difference, then we can conclude that the groups are in fact different. All of these findings tell us exactly the same thing. There is a statistically significant difference between these two means. Let's go back to our five steps of hypothesis testing. Step 4, calculate the statistics. The t-test value is a negative 3.232. We will round that to negative 3.23. The critical value was positive negative 2.306. The obtained t-value of negative 3.23 exceeds the critical value. That means that the t-test was statistically significant and the sample mean differs from the population mean. We reject the null hypothesis that says there is no difference between the sample and the population. Finally, step 5, make the decision. Men scored significantly lower than women on a test of indoor gardening. T with 8 degrees of freedom equals negative 3.23. Probability equals 0.012. But before we do the write-up, we also need to calculate the effect size. To calculate Cohen's D effect size, we will use the RStats effect size calculator for t-tests. We are calculating a Cohen's D for single sample t-tests, so click on the light purple tab for Effect Single Sample. You have two options here. Option 1 is to enter the sample mean, 66.56, the population mean, 73, and the standard deviation, 5.98, which you calculated as part of doing the test earlier. Click, and the Cohen's D is a negative 1.076. Now, option 2 requires output from SPSS. Here in the output window, double-click on the One Sample Test box to activate it. Here we need the t-value and the degrees of freedom. Highlight, copy, and then flip back to the RStats effect size calculator for t-tests. Paste the output and click. You can see that the numbers are slightly different, but they both round up to negative 1.08, so that is what we will report. We interpret a negative effect size exactly the same way that we interpret a positive effect size, just as we interpret a negative t-value the same way we interpret a positive t-value. The negative sign just tells us that the sample mean was lower than the population mean. If the sample mean had been larger than the population mean, both the effect size and the t-value would be positive. Regardless, the actual effect was still the same size. And here's how we would write up those results in APA style. A one-sample t-test was conducted to determine whether men scored differently than women on a test of indoor gardening. The mean scores for men were significantly lower than for women. T with 8 degrees of freedom equals negative 3.23. Probability equals 0.012. Cohen's D, negative 1.08, with a 95% confidence interval between negative 11.04 and negative 1.85. This suggests a gender difference in gardening skills. Notice that the T value, the P, and Cohen's D are all italicized, and the degrees of freedom, 8, is in parentheses. I changed the color of the P value here to stress the difference between the write-up that we did by hand, using P less than 0.05, and the write-up from SPSS, which reports the actual probability. That last statement about gender difference would go in your discussion section if you were writing this up for a paper.